Hey there, Josh Powers here, and today I want to go over the new and completely overhauled Vertex blend material that comes with the Megascans plugin for Unreal 4. This plugin is included with Megascans Bridge, so be sure to download Bridge from Quixel.com today, and if you're not sure how to install the plugin, just check out the description below for a link to a video tutorial that will walk you through this process. So on that note, let's get started. The first thing we'll want to do is make sure we have a few materials to work with. In this case, I have three different surfaces that I brought in from the Megascans library from Bridge. And while these material instances are ready to be applied to a 3D asset in our scene, they're not set up to be Vertex blend materials. The good news is, setting up a blend material couldn't be any easier. First, we need to select the three materials we want to be part of our blend. The order in which you select them will determine their order in the blend material. So the first selection will be your base layer, the second will be your middle layer, and the third will be your top layer. So keep this in mind when making your selections. With our material instances selected, we'll need to open the Megascans plugin panel by clicking on this icon right here. If we go down to the bottom of the panel, we'll see a couple of options for material blend. We'll want to go ahead and give our blend material a name, and we can also give it a custom path. However, in this case, I'm happy with the default location, so we'll leave that alone. Then all we need to do is simply click the Create Material Blend button, and the material has been generated for us. So if we go to our content folder, you'll see a new subfolder has been created for us called Blend Materials. If we go inside that folder, we'll see the new blend material instance we've created. This material is ready to be used on any static mesh we have in our scene. However, before we get to painting, let's take a quick moment to go over the settings inside this new material. At first glance, it might seem a bit intimidating, but don't worry. These settings are here to give you as much control as you might need, but you'll only need to adjust what you want to establish the look you're going for. So you can tweak these settings as much or as little as you wish. However, let's quickly go over them so you have a better understanding of what they do. At the top of the material, we have some global parameters. And the first one on the list is Use Puddle Layer. This is off by default, so if you want to enable the puddle layer for the material, click the checkbox on the left to activate the option, and then set the option to true by checking this box on the right. This will let you paint down some watery puddles, which I'll show you how to do in a bit. Next, we have the option to activate some additional adjustment settings for each of our layers. So if I turn on the base layer adjustment option, you'll see that we have some new values to tweak for this layer. Below the adjustment layers, we have Use Individual Displacement Value. By default, all three materials share a universal displacement value. This just helps keep things a little more streamlined. However, if there's an instance where you want control over these settings on each layer, you can check this option and then you'll be able to change each one independently. Next, we have several settings that'll let us adjust the appearance of our blends, including the amount, contrast, and falloff of the blend. We can also invert the blend for even more control. Below that is our base layer texture. The settings here will give us the flexibility to alter the appearance of the texture layer itself. For example, we can change the tiling and offset of the entire layer. You'll also notice that in order to adjust these settings, you'll need to click on this arrow to the left of the description. And that's because this material, as well as others included in the plugin, now store multiple parameters into a single vector parameter node. So for parameters that don't have the word tint or color in the name, it means that multiple parameters are accessible within the dropdown. In addition to tiling and offset, we can also change the rotation angle of the texture, increase or decrease the normal map strength, and because we turned on the Use Base Layer Adjustments in the global parameters, we can also change the saturation, brightness, and contrast here. We can adjust the color tint here, and then we also have some specular settings that we can play with if we want to, as well as a min and max roughness value. And remember, if some of these settings aren't visible to you, make sure you activate the Use Layer Adjustment option for whichever layer you're wanting to adjust. Beneath these settings are the texture input slots. These are automatically set by the plugin based on our initial material selection. However, if we decide to swap them out, we can easily do that here. Below the base layer, we have the middle and top layers. These settings are identical to the base layer settings, so let's go ahead and move to the puddle layer. These settings are pretty straightforward, and they let you control how the puddle will render in your scene, as well as how it will interact with other blend layers. You can even give the puddles some wave information so that it looks like there are ripples in the water. This is a great option to enable if, for example, the scene you're creating has some wind that you want represented in the puddles. The puddle layer is a relatively inexpensive way to add a lot of detail to your surfaces. Then lastly, we have displacement settings. By default, displacement is not being used. However, if you click on this checkbox here, we can crank up the displacement level on the material. As I mentioned before, you can alter the value on an individual layer basis by checking the Use Individual Displacement Values option in the global parameters at the top of the layer. And if you want to control the distance offset, distance fade, and tessellation, you can do that for each layer by going into the vector dropdowns. Alright, so now that we have a better idea of the control we have over this material, let's go ahead and drag it onto the plane mesh I created. The only major consideration that must be taken into account when making the geometry you plan to use is that it must have adequate vertex distribution. Since this material utilizes vertex colors to reveal the different texture sets, you'll need to be sure to have vertices to paint on. The great thing about this material is that we can get some very realistic blends without needing the geometry to be terribly dense. However, I recommend having a healthy amount of evenly spaced vertices to work with so that you can make paint strokes wherever you need to. Okay, so now that we have the material applied to our mesh, we can begin painting. It's worth noting that I'm using Unreal Engine 4.25.3. This build has a bit of a different UI layout for the tools, including the painting tools. So if you're using an earlier version of Unreal, the UI location for the painting tool will most likely be different. Alright, with the paint tool activated, the first thing we'll want to notice is the channels. By default, the base material is going to be what's visible to us at first. However, we can begin painting the other layers on top of that, and to do that, we need to change which channel we're painting on. The red channel will reveal our middle layer, while the green channel will reveal our top layer. And the blue channel will allow us to paint our puddle layers if we have that feature activated in the material. So let's start by painting down some of our middle material. Before we do this, however, let's make two quick adjustments to our brush settings. First, we'll swap the paint colors by pressing the angled arrow icon here, or by pressing X on the keyboard. And then we'll reduce the brush strength to around 0.15 to keep the strokes a little less intense. Now we're ready to paint. Right away, we can see that the blending is not all that convincing. As it stands, the painting goes from the base texture layer to the middle with nothing more than a gradual fall off blending the two layers, which is a fairly dated approach. Fortunately, our new blend material leverages height map data to determine how these two materials should blend together. So let's hop back into the material instance and play with a few of the settings to get this feeling a little more natural. We'll want to activate this base slash middle layer blend control vector first, and then open the vector by clicking on this arrow, which will show us our settings. The blend amount effectively lets us choose which layer's height map is influencing the blend and how much. So as we move the value up, we're going to see the brick's height map affecting the blend. Whereas if we go down to zero or even negative, it'll be utilizing the vegetation layer's map. So by moving this value up a bit, we see how the blend between the two layers went from a simple linear falloff to actually respecting the height data for the base layer, which gives us some really nice and believable results. We can also adjust the contrast, which will increase or decrease the effect of the blend. And then we can also adjust the falloff to determine how sharp or soft that transition is. And we can invert this blend as well. So as we pull it one way, we're further restricting the results to be limited to the grout lines, whereas if we pull it the other way, it's going to be the opposite of that. So with these settings in place, we can begin to further paint this layer onto our mesh. Because we lowered the brush strength, by repeatedly clicking over the same areas, we can watch the realistic blend gradually increase with each stroke. And if we hold down shift while painting, we'll lightly erase the strokes, which really helps sell the believability of the blend. Alright, now if we switch to the green channel, we can begin painting down our top layer. Just like we did with the middle layer, we'll want to play with the blend amount, contrast, and falloff until we're happy with the look of the blend, and then we'll be good to paint. While I'm pretty happy with this texture here, I do want to change a few of the settings for the layer itself. So I'm going to go back to the material and activate the Use Top Layer Adjustments options in the global parameters. I'll tweak a few of these values, such as increasing the tiling amount, normal strength, and even the albedo saturation, brightness, and tint to give me a slightly different look from the original material. Now we're ready to paint down more of this layer. And since this layer is the top layer, it'll paint directly on top of all the other layers except for the puddle layer. And speaking of puddles, let's go ahead and paint some of those as well. To do that, we first have to make sure that the Use Puddle Layer option is activated in the global parameters. Then all we need to do is switch our painting to the blue channel, and we can begin painting our puddle layer down to add some water elements to our blend. Because this layer is procedurally driven, we have numerous properties we can adjust to customize what these puddles will look like. So we can make some changes to settings like watercolor, the height at which the layer begins to blend with the other materials, the water's opacity, and several other options that will let you custom tailor the puddle layer for your scene. As I said before, this is a great way to add a nice touch to your environment. While the Vertex blend material is ideal for ground surfaces, it can be leveraged in many different ways to give a unique appearance to all kinds of instance assets. So be sure to experiment with it and see what you come up with. Between the new height blending technique and the numerous other customizable settings accessible to you, the new Vertex blend material is a simple yet very effective way to bring your world to life. So be sure to grab Megascans Bridge to take advantage of this new Vertex blend material, as well as all the other features that come with the plugin. Thank you so much for watching, and we'll see you in the next one.